Hi, I'm Michael Correa, and this is Psych Exam Review. In this video, I want to introduce some ideas related to problem solving. So how do we solve problems? Well, sometimes the way that we solve problems is that we don't actually have to solve them. We have a memory for a solution, and we simply need to bring it to mind. So for instance, if I ask you to solve 2 plus 2, you can immediately tell me that the answer is 4, and you don't really have to go through any problem solving steps. Whereas in some point in the past, you did actually have to solve this problem. You had to work at it and find the solution. And you probably did this by physically representing the problem, you know, on your fingers and then counting 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, 2 plus 2 is 4. And now you have that solution and you memorize it and you can bring it to mind later when you need it. And it's not going to change. Right? So sometimes we simply call on our memory for how we've solved a problem in the past. Now, this can lead us to a problem in that sometimes we call upon old solutions that aren't going to work for new problems. And this brings us to what's called mental set. So mental set is the idea that we use a problem-solving approach that has worked in the past, but it might not necessarily work for a new problem, but it's sort of the first thing that we go to. So for instance, if you've had problems with your computer in the past, and you've solved these problems simply by restarting your computer, and that's resolved the issue, then if you have a new problem with your computer, you're likely to try restarting your computer to solve this problem, even if this solution isn't necessarily going to work. Right? So that would be a demonstration of your mental set. You have an approach to solving computer problems, which is to restart the computer, and you try that with a new problem, even though you don't know if it's going to work, and it may not resolve the issue that you're having. Now, we also have this tendency to rely on sort of past solutions when it comes to how we use tools, because we tend to think of the usefulness of tools in terms of how we've used them before or how they're generally used. And so when we're referring to tools, we call this functional fixedness. And this is the idea that the functions of tools are seen as fixed. They don't change. That we use a tool for a particular purpose and that purpose only. So for instance, if you were trying to hang a picture on your wall and you needed to hammer a nail into the wall, you might go and get your toolbox and then you open it up and you remember that you lent your hammer to a friend last weekend and you forgot to get it back. So now you might think, well, I guess I can't hang up the picture today. Instead of realizing that there's a wrench in front of you and you could use the wrench to drive a nail into the wall, and in this case, that would pretty much work just as well as a hammer. But you might overlook this because of functional fixedness. You think of hammers are for hammering things, wrenches are for wrenching things, and you fail to see that you could use the wrench as a hammer. Now, this functional fixedness is often described as an error in problem solving. But I don't really think it's an error. Because a lot of the time, functional fixedness is a good thing. It keeps us from damaging our tools and ruining their ability to perform their special task that they're designed for. So we don't always want to think of all the possible uses for something. I mean, sure, you could use your cell phone to hammer a nail into a wall. That would probably work. It would get the job done. But in doing that, you'd destroy the functions that your cell phone is specifically designed to perform. And so in that case, functional fixedness isn't really an error. Sure, you don't think of using your cell phone as a hammer, but that most of the time, that's probably a good thing. Okay, so thinking about the different uses for tools brings us to consider the difference between convergent thinking and divergent thinking. So what do these refer to? Well, convergent thinking is when we have a problem that has a single solution. And so all of the steps that we take, all of the approaches that we have, should all point us to this one solution. You can think of it as we have a single solution, and everything we do should point us toward that solution. So for instance, if you're solving an algebra equation, and you're solving for x, and there's one answer that x can be, then each of the steps that you take in solving this problem should get you closer to finding that answer of what is x. Right? So we have many approaches that all point us to a single solution. This is convergent thinking. Everything converges onto one solution. In contrast, we also have what's called divergent thinking. And in divergent thinking, we diverge from a single point. So we have a starting point, and then we have multiple solutions, and these solutions sort of go off in different directions. And by that, I mean, they may not be related to one another at all. And so this is a bit more creative, right? We have to come up with new unrelated ideas for maybe how we could use a particular tool. That would be an example of divergent thinking. So if you took your hammer and you said, what are all of the possible things that I could use a hammer for? You're going to come up with many different answers, and they're not going to be related to one another. So you could say, okay, I could use a hammer as a paperweight, or I could use it to help me reach something. You know, that's just out of reach. If I had a hammer, then I'd get a little bit longer reach, and maybe I could, you know, knock something off a shelf. Or you could say, well, maybe I could use it to prop a door open so I don't get stuck outside. Or, you know, I could use it as a weapon if I needed to. Or maybe I could use it as a clock, in which case it's always hammer time. But anyway, this shows us that we have multiple different solutions to a problem, and they're not related to one another. And so this creativity comes from this divergent thinking, trying to come up with new unrelated solutions. And this is something we might not do as often as, you know, the convergent thinking, where we're focused on finding a single solution to a single problem. Okay, so that's mental set and functional fixedness and the difference between convergent and divergent thinking. I hope you found this helpful. If so, please like the video and subscribe to the channel for more. Thanks for watching.